like the Caribbean ones. ICAST expresses one voice and the necessity of acting together through different ways, especially through technical cooperation activities. More than ever, we have to look for resilience and linking with food and nutrition security. So thank you once again for coming. This is your house.
Thank you very much, Director General. Thank you. Just in time. Yes, so you would notice the title, How Commonwealth Countries Growing Together for Climate Resilience, Food and Nutrition. I think the central issue here for us is that what we have there is a joint endeavor. And I think the notion that any one country, any one nation can do it alone is a fallacy. And we need to find solutions working together, bringing together our collective resources to solve the dynamic space. I think we will start down the line while they try to sort out the challenges. So we're going to start off, I think Honorable Secretary General, I think I'm going to start with you and come back around. Yes, the question I'm going to pose to you, what can be done to strengthen climate resilience and food and nutrition security? Are these opportunities for us to strengthen across the region of the
I think the short answer to that is yes. All of us have understood very tragically the impact that climate change in the exogenous shocks such as COVID-19 has had on our agricultural sector and basically on Representative. The Global Research Alliance was formed has a strong focus on resilience to climate change, the mitigation of climate change. So this is a very new fund, and we'll be looking forward to working with Caribbean countries and definitely our Commonwealth partners as a Commonwealth country ourselves to see how we can support the initiatives and particularly around its togetherness. How do we grow together? How can we work together to improve the resilience of our culture?
Thank you very much. Unfortunately, we are still having some connectivity issues. So, at the budget, we would have really liked the views Caribbean represents a large proportion of the countries which are members of the Commonwealth. But I trust, you know, some of the views that you expressed in the Hill Cactus, you know, to the races. But let's continue the discussion. I'm going to ask you a question now. I think Minister Sweetin, Minister Sweetin,
champions have continued to express in the Commonwealth ever since. And if you look at the most recent Commonwealth Heads of Government meeting in Kigali, there was solidarity in relation to what we needed to do in relation particularly to climate change, but also look at what we agreed to do on the Living Lands Charter, which is going to implement the three Rio conventions. So that's solidifying of our determination, this Lands Charter, which is going to implement the three Rio conventions. Loss and damage
Thank you.
quite a gap. When industry launched a climate smart grant initiative, where this grant only focused on climate smart agriculture to help farmers who didn't have access to water. So if they applied for solar pumps, that grant was an initiative for that. To solarize farms, this grant initiative was for that. Also for technology research that catered to climate smart initiatives, this grant initiative was for that. And the issue for the Bahamas is we don't have enough funding to help to develop this sector as much as we'd like. So for me, unity is something that is an issue that's very important. Climate smart agriculture, especially in the Bahamas where we have these developing islands where some islands don't have access to water. Some islands don't have access to proper soil testing. Some islands are in the jeopardy of hurricanes because of climate change. So in the Bahamas, we have all of these challenges, but with unity, working together, and as we continue to develop technologies, whether it's through CARICOM for the coming month, I think it's important that we share this technical expertise, that we are able to share this technology. We've been working with Guyana as well as Jamaica, and now hopefully New Zealand with these technological innovations that assist us to get to the next level. And I continue to speak about youth and women in the sector because they are our future. What's amazing to me is in the Bahamas, we have big semi-annual meetings with farmers. And 60% of these meetings are made up by women. So for women to have this interest in the sector, it proves that we are getting them. We just have to find a way to keep them interested and to keep them involved. And through technology, vertical farming, other areas such as small cities, agricultural cities, I think that we'll continue to make that step in that program. So for me, the community is important to share information and other funding opportunities for the Bahamas and the community.
Thank you very much.
We see now more than ever, at least in my lifetime, that conflict, whether real or artificial, between politics and science, is stemming here from the framework of the Commonwealth of the Asian. Okay, so that means we recognize the need to work together. But the question I pose to you, and your own personal view, how should the science go in a global informing political decision with the issues we face in the
world. Yeah, thank you. I think it's a very interesting question in the sense that I come from a country, New Zealand, where there has always been a very strong interaction between science and policy. One of the things that we found, particularly in the global research alliance work, that often the policy world, the science world, does not interact very well. And we've particularly found that where we have been successful, and I've worked in Kenya, Ethiopia, and we're now working a lot in Southeast Asia, is where we have been able to bring policy and science together to try and speak the same language, because scientists speak in code. They use acronyms, they speak in complex phrases, but that has to be boiled down into simple, understandable language that can help policymakers and vice versa. And I think it's the growing together bit. And scientists and policymakers need to grow together. Scientists need to get out of their ivory towers, which they're very, very difficult to do. And I think sometimes policymakers also have to understand and be guided by some of the science concerned. It's kind of evidence-informed policy in science, but it's getting the mechanisms right. And often we have a lot of platitudes about science and policy talking. We don't necessarily
whether that really
No, no, very, very, very
question.
Good. Very good perspective. We have heard the initial views. Of course, there are many dimensions to the topic at hand, but I think I would like to imply that unfortunately, the moment I've had a list of questions on the ecology has given us today, but we do have a gallery there, and I would like to invite, we have a lot of experience in the panel. I would like to invite a few questions, maybe three questions.
Everything you can assure area.
indigenous knowledge is one of the real challenges, and so the Global Research Alliance has formed an indigenous knowledge network, because it's increasingly recognized that solutions are local, and they need to be locally appropriate using knowledge systems that are locally appropriate. And you know, it's very easy to point to massive technological failure from what we might call high-tech science. And this, particularly in this area of sustainability, because you can very easily develop highly productive agriculture that is not sustainable in the long term. And I think that's where we all need to work together around that and use all sources of knowledge to get locally appropriate solutions, and solutions that take into account the multiple facets of agriculture and food production. It's not just about food production. What about biodiversity? The whole that goes with it. And indigenous knowledge has got a really big part to play in ensuring that there are locally appropriate solutions that are long-term solutions and not solutions that give rise to another problem that we're going to try and fix in the next few years.
Thank you very much. Carlos Canisius from Bahamas. We have a hydroponic farming company, vertical hydroponic farming company called Eden Farms. And one of the biggest challenges that we found is data regarding market data. So there's a lot of data that can be that's available around growing techniques, even around seasonal techniques. An event we recently attended, it was explained, for example, in 2004 after the tsunami, that just giving the fishermen cell phones allowed them to increase their household income by 33% just by knowing how much fish it cost. We also found through our networking in the Caribbean that it's the same challenges, that oftentimes, because we're in tourism sectors, prices get negotiated to a point where it makes it impossible almost to provide for families. So while technology and techniques are important, how can we allow market data and even market variability, because agriculture of course is like a commodity that varies based on seasons, etc., to allow for persons to make sustainable livelihoods in such a competitive field?
Thanks. We spoke about this a few times it reminds me that my former life I was a fisherman, commercial fisherman, and there was a period where the fishermen didn't have access to current markets internationally. So during that period, the fishermen sold their product at a less price because they didn't know what the current international market was. Over time, the fishermen has had access to this market, so now they're able to maximize what they sell their product for. This, what Mr. Palacios is speaking about, does not exist currently that I'm aware of, where farmers in the Bahamas can compete with imported food because they don't understand what the current market price is for tomatoes, for lettuce. So a lot of times they sell possibly at a lower rate because they can't compete even though it's being local. So I hope that there's something, when we speak about sharing innovation and sharing technology, that this is something that another country has been the forerunner, that is able to share this with the Bahamas so that markets that the agriculture sector don't have access to can now to be able to compete with the U.S. and other areas where they have been
farming. I think this is an area which we've already started to make an inroad on. I think our innovation hub was once described by someone else as if I is really interesting when we look at the data that's being collected by each country, definitely wasn't being shared. And it was very difficult to map your strategic plan or make your strategic plan for developing your market if you didn't understand what every other country in your region was doing, because quite often there was a market share that was available to you that you didn't know about. So I'd say please go and look at what we have come up with in our new report. This is work in progress. We absolutely understand that we have to get data into the hands of the states and the individuals. And at the moment, the Colossal Italian is trying to create a micro, small, and medium-sized business app so that small business, including those in agriculture, in the palm of your hand, will have a lot of the advice that you need that's not currently available. And anybody who'd like to come and help us with that would be really grateful. So if you know any of your friends who are burdened with money, tell them that you know someone who can relieve them of that burden.
I would respond, I think, with support that the market data is massively, and I come from a very different perspective. New Zealand exports 95% of its agricultural produce. New Zealand has 40% of the world's tradable milk. It has 60% of the world's tradable land. And it's no sort of, it's not some lucky sort of fortunate exercise it does that. It has very strong market data. It knows where its competitive advantage is. We don't have water supply issues. We're a pastorally based society. We're blessed with a very good climate for temperate agriculture, producing milk and meat from Greenland animals. And our market data is very important in saying what product should be produced to which markets, and are we competitive in the price that we can do that. Now we're trying to diversify, as everyone else is. We don't want to be reliant on milk being purchased by China, because I can't actually remember the numbers, but an enormous amount of our trade is now with China. If China stopped, the New Zealand economy would tank. So like everyone else, we want to diversify. And we have a climate that can grow very high value horticultural produce, but we don't have the developed markets for that. So our next challenge is to develop in markets in line with how we can increase our production. And all that comes back down to great data, market data. What are our competitors? What can they produce it at? What can we produce it at? So I really support the issue of data and understanding your markets and understanding your competitors. And sometimes you can't actually produce at the same price as your competitors. Then it comes back to me to the political decisions around how important is it that your country is self-sufficient. And then we come back to the COVID type situations in Europe now. In a couple of years ago, no one thought about food security in the same way as they do now. When the Ukraine stopped supplying the world's largest wheat producer, suddenly can't supply. So having a diversity of sources is not looked at in the same way as having your own source as well. So there are very political decisions to make around balancing trade and balancing your own food security.
There's one thing that's too helpful is the issue of data. I'm going to ask two simple questions here. The first
innovation hub was really created during COVID, and we had the COVID resources to come in. Not used to working together, planning together, sharing information. And what we know therefore is that we need partners. One of the things that the DG and I are doing is looking at how we can share our data in real time and make a difference. We've got about 50 partnerships with the WTO, with the UNCTAD, with IFC, all of those. But in addition, we are working in partnership with people like Bloomberg. So we now have the Bloomberg data, and we are migrating that data with the data that we're getting from the States. And so dependent on the quality of the data sets that are coming from our member states, we can migrate that data, we can analyze it in a sort of granularity that puts back the information to our member states in a way that makes sense and enables them to use it. But I want to reassure you that Genius is not limited to the large member states. So we have real innovators and genius in each of our regions, and we have 33 of the small, of the 32 small states in the Commonwealth. Just to cheer you up, if you look at the number of Nobel Prizes per capita, Caribbean does pretty well.
I'd actually like to link your question back to the previous one around indigenous knowledge. This is not about rich countries telling poor countries. This is about learning from each other and growing together. We all have something to teach each other, and I think that's what we've tried to do in the Global Research Alliance. It is about working together for a common good and learning from each other. It is not a one-way transfer of information.
Thank you. So, colleagues, I'm going to read it in discussion. We have our final few minutes. So, my final question before I ask you to just give a comment. In your views, in personal experience, do you think that agriculture has been treated fairly in the climate change debate? And do you think agriculture should be given a more prominent position, placement in future dialogue and action in the climate change debate? What are your personal views on that? In any order.
Thank you. So, when I speak about agriculture, and I look over the previous 20 years, we've been speaking a lot about climate change. I think only of late agriculture is still in the forefront. And I don't think necessarily because of climate change, I think because of COVID and the realities of countries around the world wanting to feed themselves. I think that now, because we realize how important food security is, now we're tied into the climate change narrative. And then we realize in countries such as the Bahamas, where climate change is one of the major reasons why we don't feed ourselves. Because year after year, we have this cycle of hurricanes where farmers are investing a load of money to grow and to start to plant these farms. And the reality is that the cycle just gets frustrating to them. So for us to say that agriculture has played a role or is in the climate change talks, I think it's a byproduct of COVID and food security. And now we realize that climate change is one of those things that protect agriculture. For the Bahamas, we're adapting to climate change. We don't contribute to how it affects the world, the world around us. So we're trying to find ways to adapt through climate smart initiatives, through climate grants, through areas where we don't get water, to salinity issues.
signed up to do. So now we're all about implementation. And this commitment from our 56 countries was clear because in June we agreed to come together to implement the Living Lands Charter, which will be creating action groups in our countries to actually make the charter's aspirations real. So I agree absolutely with what you said. Before, it was a nice to have. After COVID, it's an absolute essential. And I said when I became Commonwealth Secretary General, I wanted to put the wealth back into Commonwealth. But I also wanted to put the common back into wealth. And we can't do that unless we address those issues.
It's a very difficult question, but I think where I see it, and particularly from the developed world perspective, from rich people who've got very full stomachs, provide a lot of very simple solutions. You should all become vegan, you should stop eating meat, you should... I'm sorry, that's not a solution. This is the kind of, for every complex problem, there's a simple solution, it's invariably wrong. This is complex. We're facing a challenge of probably 10 billion people with an increase in food demand of at least 30%. How do we do that within the context of land management, within the context of climate change, within the context of livelihood? Well, I don't think we have given it the focus it deserves, and actually given it the treatment that a very complex problem deserves. It's not simple, it's highly complex. The first thing to do is recognize the complexity, and then work together to see how we can bring about solutions. At the moment, I just do not think we've really addressed the complexity of the issue to some extent.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Let me invite you.
Economic and environmental. We're now talking about cultural lines of social, economic, environmental, and cultural. And the cultural one is so important in terms of how we address the issue. And you want me to go to a closing remark, because it's basically for me, it was the title. We're all in this together. There's a lovely phrase in Māori, Hiwaka Ekana, which means we're all in the same canoe and paddling in the same direction. And we need to be. This is a wicked problem. And unless we tackle it together, we will not succeed.
Yeah, so I agree with you in regards to the culture and the food from the meat. I mean, as I travel across the Caribbean, I enjoy traveling there to enjoy the food culture. So that's one aspect that I agree that we must preserve and continue. But in my closing remarks, very interesting discussion today. I want to thank me and the panelists here to show all of you. But as we sit here today, in November, the Bahamas is facing another track to Dorian, which was 3 years ago. Not as strong, but strong enough to cause issues for the farmers there. So when we speak about climate change and the effects of it, this is one of the reasons why farmers in these areas do not get involved in the sector, because it's a continued revolving door and they face these issues and have to investigate, like I said. So currently they're preparing for a storm while we sit here and speak about climate change. And being a millennial, still pretty young, millennials and young people want action. We sit here and have these discussions and speak about what needs to be done, what could have done, how we could do it. But the reality is, are we doing it? And are we touching the people's lives in the Commonwealth who we speak so much about? We need to have this unity. And with this unity, we need to affect the lives of the farmers, the lives of the people. That is the reason that we're here. The reason that we travel all these miles to speak and to meet with one another is to find tangible issues, to solve those issues and the results that can touch their lives. So I hope that this unity, this discussion, continues after these 3 weeks of COP, that we're able to go back to our people, to our respective countries, to say these are the results, whether it's in funding opportunities, where the Bahamas can't qualify a lot of the times because we're in this threshold where the GDP is too high and we can't meet the threshold to receive funding. So how do we work together that we're able to solve these issues that we have been talking about for consecutive years, for consecutive decades? And I always tell the people in my country, in the Bahamas, that I'm here for a short period of time as a minister. In my 5 years, I want to make the largest impact that I can make. So once my time is done, I left a legacy that transcends politics, that transcends governments, that have made an impression and will help to secure our country in regards to that.
Well, I always want to just say, I agree. Because culture is really important also. I couldn't help but just remember going to Amoco and Grand Bahama immediately after Hurricane Dorian and seeing the devastation. I think it's important for us just to hold in our minds why we are all here today. But also, if I could just mention my own country of birth. In 2015, we were struck by Tropical Storm Erica. It destroyed 95% of our GDP. We were then basically annihilated in 2017 by Maria, which was the biggest hurricane before Dorian. And Dorian was even a bigger beast than Maria. But that destroyed 226% of our GDP. As I sit here, my poor country has been hit again by floods and storms, and someone died yesterday as a result. Now, one person dying doesn't sound a lot, but when you have less than 72,000 people, some people think we now only have about 60,000 people in Dominica. After those two tragedies, I know that today there will be children in my country of birth who will not sleep, who will suffer from post-traumatic shock, because this trauma will remind them of the trauma of Maria and the trauma of Erica. So I think we need to be really clear about why we're here. In the Caribbean, we would say we're not making a joke. This is hard work. dimensional vulnerability index, which means that we're not just going to be dependent anymore on assessing someone's GDP. When Bahamas was hit by Dorian, I wish someone had told the hurricane, don't hit us here because we're a high-income country. The hurricanes don't care if you're high-income, medium-income, low-income. When they take all your development and dump it into the sea, I believe we should say the debt can be dumped with it. Vulnerability. We've offered the Bridge Town Initiative, looking at the IFIs to make a difference. We need to do all of it. And all I can say as the Commonwealth Secretariat is we are there with you as your partner. I'm so proud of the work we're doing with the DG and with others. And I need to say to all of us, we can do this. We just have to choose to be the difference we need to make. Madiba said that looking at apartheid in South Africa, everything is impossible until it's